Black Tusk is a secretive private military contractor with ties to political, industrial, and military leaders in the United States. Their goal is to pave the way for a new dynasty with their employers at the head of this new world order. They are disciplined and highly organized, have fast manpower, and their unparalleled and advanced equipment make them the largest threat the Strategic Homeland Division has ever faced. Rumored to have foreknowledge of mankind's worst pandemic, the green poison, Black Tusk are using their advanced equipment and vast manpower to pave the way for a new dynasty. However, we're left with many questions. Who is behind the shadowy organization that hired Black Tusk? Did they know about the green poison outbreak before it happened? And what are Black Tusk's plans for the outbreak? In this faction brief, I will explain their origins, sketch a timeline, and dive in depth on every detail important to their story. Let's begin. We're starting pre-outbreak. Although its exact origins remain shrouded in mystery and what looks like deliberate misinformation, Black Tusk is comprised of military and paramilitary units with a long history of working for shadowy elements of the United States government in conflict zones around the world. Black Tusk operatives have been actively deployed in operations ranging from covert regime-changing operations to underground counter-insurgency efforts in a wide array of hotspots in Latin America, the Middle East, Southeast Asia, and North Africa. The current configuration is clearly recruited in direct response to the green poison bioterror attack on Black Friday. Black Tusk units and equipment began shipping back to the United States in the very early hours of the outbreak, before the full extent of the crisis was even known. This suggests the disturbing possibility of foreknowledge from rogue elements in the United States government and military, which is further solidified by a statement from Roger Koopman, a former immunologist and author of New York Collapse, a Survival Guide to Urban Catastrophe.
Thanks to associates in various intelligence communities, I suspected there was an active plot to release a bioengineered virus. But I did not know anything beyond that. No hint of who was doing it or when it might happen. All I knew was that the plot existed, and that elements within the government also suspected it, and were supportive of it, if you can believe that. As I said, there are rogue elements in the government and military who saw a possible catastrophe as a means to power.
It turns out Koopman was right. Andrew Ellis, at the time Speaker of the House of Representatives, was approached by a mysterious benefactor, an unknown messenger with an interesting opportunity.
Andrew Ellis?
Who is this?
A messenger. I believe Senator Richards was already in contact with you.
He certainly piqued my curiosity. I'd be interested to hear what exactly your friends have in mind and how I would fit into the equation.
Excellent. It would be best to discuss the specifics in person, of course.
That can be arranged.
Black Tusk's approach of Senator Richards and Ellis shows the ties Black Tusk are making to powerful political figures in the United States government. Black Tusk contracting Ellis shouldn't come as a surprise. As his profile states, Ellis aspires to build a brand new America and is willing to do whatever it takes to achieve his goals. This is further solidified by a poster in the Grand Washington Hotel in Washington, D.C., showing Ellis was the chairman for a seminar on how private sector business leads to greater outcomes. Sometime in the month after, Ellis was approached by the CEO of Black Tusk and would be briefed on the exact way how the situation would go down.
Mr. Ellis, good to finally meet you.
I'm sorry, you are?
You've been briefed on Black Tusk?
Yes, of course.
Well, I run the outfit.
I understand I have you to thank for my good fortunes.
Yeah, well, don't let it go to your head. We all have our parts to play. Which is what we need to talk about. I want to lay out exactly how this is going to go down.
Should I take notes?
Now, what you should do is give me your full attention. Almost as if, your life depended on it.
November 23rd, day zero. Banknotes coated with variola chimera, the smallpox strain now called green poison, circulates in New York City. Packed crowds moving in frenetic, wide-ranging patterns spread the infection and carry it away from ground zero. December marks the start of the outbreak, as the first disease symptoms start to emerge. Within days, the contagion rages across the New York City's entire populace. The spread is so fast that containment is impossible, and President Lawrence Waller orders a lockdown of Manhattan within the first week of December. As food and supplies start running low, fear and anarchy start to spread. Federal authorities designate new containment zones in Manhattan, with central Midtown Manhattan its most dangerous sick zone. Reports coming into the division headquarters suggest that under cover of the green poison pandemic's spreading disruption, Black Tusk has already secured key strategic locations around the country. Military bases, power grid and utilities infrastructure, media communication hubs, internet server farms, certain financial institutions and high-tech corporate campuses, and so on. The sheer scale of their operations, manpower and state-of-the-art technology suggests they have access to almost unlimited funding, support and eerily precise intel. As the outbreak worsened and New York City was going into lockdown, Black Tusk got word from a company in Manhattan that was experimenting with a new type of vaccine design. A vaccine under the designation of broad-spectrum antiviral. Should this succeed, Black Tusk's entire operation would be compromised. A civilian under the name of April Kelleher described how her husband, William or Bill Kelleher, was murdered. As I got close to the building, two cars screeched up front. Bill and two other people came running out of the building. I was shocked to see him in that situation, so at first I didn't even call out to him. The men coming out of the cars had guns. There were more men coming out of the building, also with guns. I ducked behind a food truck, but kept watching because Bill was right there. It was over very quickly. The first car drove past me and I could see two men in the backseat. One of them was bloody. The other looked me right in the eye as they passed. He'd be coming out of the building with Bill. I ran the rest of the way to the building and there was Bill. Dead. The man who had come out of the building threw him onto the sidewalk and dragged Bill's body into the car while the other pointed a gun at me. They were wearing black fatigues, that's the word, military style clothes. The men who showed up in the cars first, they wore suits. I called the homicide squad and asked about Bill. They don't have any record of an incident at SBGX, or Sequent Biotech Group. It took me a minute to remember their company's full name. I told them what had happened and I don't think the desk officer or whoever was on the phone believed me. I asked to talk to a detective and after waiting on hold forever, I got one. Nina Gigiovanni. I explained to her that investigators had loaded the dead man from the car into the coroner's van and two uniformed officers had been there taping off the crime scene. I watched the whole thing, I said. Didn't they make a report? She said they didn't have any report of a homicide or firearm incident at that location. Black Tusk had both the motive and means to not only perform a liquidation like this, but also to cover up any traces of it. Additionally, they fit the description of the aggressors, making them the most obvious suspect. Field intel confirms these horrible suspicions to be true. Barton Schaefer, a high-ranking operative within Black Tusk's ranks, discusses with his supervisor the role of Black Tusk in relation to their employers.
Boss says the situation is legit.
Then it's legit, but that don't mean any of this is doable.
These are some very powerful individuals, apparently. Capable of pulling strings on folks that don't even realize they're puppets.
Pretty much guarantees a double cross, then. Guys like us are a loose end for people who don't want loose ends.
Our boss has some thoughts about that. Thinks we'll have sufficient leverage to come out okay. I think he's envisioning us as the Praetorian Guard of the new dynasty.
Well, he's ambitious, I'll give him that.
Don't forget, we have ridiculous firepower.
That does tip the scales a bit.
As it stands, the identity of the individuals within the shadowy organization are still unknown, even to Shaver and his supervisor. Halfway through December, President Waller invokes National Security Presidential Directive 51 to ensure continuity of government in the face of the growing crisis. As the POTUS is evacuated from the White House to Camp David, he immediately activates the first wave of the Strategic Homeland Division. 2 days later, in the sick zone in Midtown Manhattan, now designated the Dark Zone, the Joint Task Force, or JTF, were forced to abandon the Dark Zone's mass treatment facilities and beat a hasty retreat south, leaving any division agents. This unprecedented humanitarian disaster in New York City provided the perfect opportunity for Black Tusk as they started preparations for their invasion of the United States. The largest hurdle in their conquest would be the invasion of the capital, Washington, D.C.
Decent coffee, right?
Well, fuck if I know. I don't drink this shit for pleasure.
Trust me, it's good. You should savor it. Might be your last chance.
Man, it still tastes like dirt.
What's happening in New York is just the beginning.
Yeah, no shit.
I want you to put together a team.
I already have a team.
A bigger team, more diversified.
For what?
For whatever it takes. We have an opportunity here, a golden one. But we have to be smart, and we have to act fast.
So no choir boys is what you're saying?
I'm saying scoundrels and scum, all right? Killers and cutthroats. I don't give a shit as long as they follow orders and can get shit done.
All right, I'll get to work.
I'll work fast, the end is fucking nigh.
Black Tusk's commanding officer imposed Schaefer to create a special unit within Black Tusk, later to be called the Black Tusk Special Unit, or BTSU. This elite unit was tasked with the dismantling and elimination of the Strategic Homeland Division, the biggest obstacle in their way to a new dynasty. As the pandemic raged on, Schaefer started recruiting members for his unit.
Barden Schaefer. How are you still alive and kicking?
Odessa Sawyer, as I live and breathe. Well, Mama always said I was a cockroach. I assume she meant I was tough to kill.
I doubt it. Who are your friends?
I might do introductions, after you've heard me out.
Oh, so hush hush. What are you these days? OGA?
That's what I wanted to talk to you about. I've got a new employer, and we're hiring. Good base plus hazard pay and bonuses. And you'd be working with quality people.
Yeah? Now who would I be working for?
People who want what's best for this country.
Uh-huh.
This is a one-time deal, Odessa. Things are happening fast. You don't want to miss this bus.
I swore an oath, and I'm sticking to it. Not something I'd expect a cockroach to understand.
Well, that's a damn shame. You sure would be an asset. Be seeing you.
I sure fucking hope not.
Black Tusk's recruitment consisted of elite soldiers that have a long history of working with the United States government. Ex-Special Forces, Marines, Rangers, and even SEALs. Agents from the division, although having an opposing ideology, could be a tremendous asset if they are turned. Within the week, Schaefer contracted five operatives. Elijah Sumner, Alice Galveston, Jack Bonney, Mila Wyvern-Radek, and Patrice Brenner. Each one, with the exception of Bonney, was recruited into the military before, where they served multiple years and developed into strategic advisors or PMC contractors.
How's Bonney fitting in?
The others think he's a rabid fucking weasel. They aren't wrong.
Yeah, well, you need to make it work.
It'll work just fine. I ain't yet met a Bronco I can't break.
How soon will the unit be ready to deploy then?
Depends on the assignment. We could be ready tomorrow if we're just cracking heads, but more complicated targets will require custom training.
Look, nothing fancy for now, but there's a lot of groundwork to lay. Obstacles to be knocked down.
Knocking shit down is my specialty.
Yeah, I know it is, Barr, but you'd be ready to move out in a week, and no fuck-ups.
You have my personal guarantee.
As Schaefer was getting his unit in order, satellite surveillance shows the start of Black Tusk's invasion of the United States. Moving from their strategic locations, Black Tusk started advancing on civilian communities, JTF outposts, and areas outside of the big cities first. In the meantime, President Waller activated the second wave of the division in New York City. However, Waller was starting to show signs of struggling under the crippling pressure of the pandemic.
Where have you been? You ditching meetings now?
I was summoned by Waller.
What the hell for?
I don't know. It was strange. I think he'd been drinking.
Waller?
Yeah. I've never seen him like that. Rambling on and on about his legacy before green poison came along.
Nostalgic for the good old days, when America wasn't collapsing around him.
I guess. He kept telling me that Mendez means well and needs allies. The implication being that I should be nicer to him.
Yeah, we'd all be nicer to him if he was less of a dipshit.
I wonder if Waller is thinking of resigning.
Oh, God help us if he does.
The stress of the outbreak took its toll and Waller collapsed from a massive heart attack. As per the 25th Amendment, Vice President Thomas Eliezer Mendez was the next in line to become president. Mendez was sworn in as president in Washington DC and refused to leave while the then Vice President Ellis and other surviving members of the government were evacuated to NORAD headquarters in Colorado Springs. Mendez was considered horrible at leading the country because of his unwillingness to make decisions, and many thought he was unfit for the position.
Oh, I gotta run. Mendez wants to talk to me about something.
Lucky you. I'm sure it will be stupefying.
God, there's gotta be a way to get this guy out of office.
Believe me, thinking about that is what I do instead of sleeping these days.
You sure you'd want to be in his shoes?
Absolutely not.
Well, somebody has to step up. And you're not allergic to making decisions.
That I'm not.
It wasn't long before Mendez supposedly committed suicide. Many people had suspicioned it wasn't a suicide, and audio recordings and echoes confirmed Black Tusk was involved.
He's left-handed.
Huh?
He would have held the pistol in his left hand.
Big fucking deal. You think anyone's going to notice?
I think we had best not take chances, unless we want to face the consequences.
Whatever.
Wipe the grip and do the job properly.
Fine.
There. You happy? Of course not. This situation is completely fucked.
Oh, Mendez wasn't going to unfuck it. That's for damn sure.
Can't dispute that.
Mendez is dead.
Let me guess. Tragic case of involuntary suicide?
Something like that.
What a proud moment in the illustrious history of the Secret Service. I say that in all seriousness. That guy was a disaster.
You think we can hurry this up?
Got someone with B-techs?
Yeah, anywhere but here. You promised safe passage out of the city.
You boys certainly earned yourselves an express ticket out of this predicament. I think you got him, Brenner. Yeah, you got him.
I had to be sure.
Get him stowed. We're done here.
I guess you haven't heard about Mendez.
Who is this Mendez you speak of? Sounds like a real moron.
Not anymore.
Oh, he's resigning?
He's dead. He offed himself, apparently.
Mendez?
Yeah, no shit. Uncharacteristic of him to actually follow through on something, but now it's all going to be on you. Hope you're ready for it.
Ellis was sworn into presidency from NORAD HQ and announced to his staff that he was working with Black Tusk. However, Ellis trusted one colleague enough to tell him about the deal he had struck with them.
Jesus, Andrew. Are you sure about this?
You said it yourself. Somebody has to step up.
What do you know about these people? Can you trust them?
I'm just a pawn as far as they're concerned.
Isn't that kind of a shitty position to put yourself in?
The thing is, pawns are dangerous, precisely because people underestimate them.
You think you can turn this to your advantage?
I'm confident I can make myself indispensable and get some things done that have needed doing for a good long time.
I don't know. This is a dangerous game to play.
Is there any other kind these days?
As Black Tusk continued their invasion of the United States and Ellis picked up his duties as president, the mysterious benefactor that messaged Ellis before the outbreak, codenamed Mantis, contacted Ike Ronson, a division agent in New York City. Sentinel, this is Mantis, acknowledge. We have intercepted comms indicating a civilian in possession of valuable intel has left Manhattan. Your orders are as follows. Pursue the individual, engage and assist as needed. Ascertain her destination and observe. Name, Kelleher, April. White female, early 30s, hair red-brown, eyes blue, height approximately 5'7", medium build. Maybe in possession of a division backpack, armed. Probable destination, Ann Arbor, Michigan. Kelleher, after having met Koopman, found out her husband and other parties in Manhattan progressed the research on broad-spectrum antivirals. In her goal to find answers on her husband's death, Kelleher started hiking towards Ann Arbor, Michigan. Months later, in May, slightly south of Ann Arbor, Ronson caught up with her and escorted her to the biomedical research facility on the edge of North Campus. Upon arrival, Professor Kavita Chandrasekhar, the lead researcher in Ann Arbor, confirmed the existence of the broad-spectrum antiviral. An entire batch, 24 doses. However, it wasn't on location. The scientific advisor of President Ellis had requested the synthesized antiviral serum was sent to Washington, D.C. for secure handling.
Our primary task is to reclaim the capital from the hostile forces that presently control it. These include operatives of the Strategic Homeland Division, now considered a rogue agency that must be brought to heel. Civilian militias and remnants of the three dominant factions active within the area of operations must disarm and submit to the rule of law, or they will be classified as insurgent groups and dealt with accordingly. We have seen little evidence that anyone in this shithole of a city intends to play nice. So I advise that you shoot first and shoot last. It is notoriously easier to negotiate.
Black Tusk, aware of the development of the broad-spectrum antivirals, sent troops to secure the research facility in Ann Arbor and contacted Ellis to order him back to Washington, D.C. Black Tusk couldn't risk the broad-spectrum antiviral falling into the hands of the Division. The Division didn't know of Ellis' true loyalty and, as per Directive 51, still answered to him.
Hey, we need you in D.C.
D.C.? Why?
Look, our biggest obstacle in this whole venture is the Strategic Homeland Division. Now, technically, they answer to you. Realistically, they're a bunch of self-governing cowboys who answer to no one.
You think they're going to be a problem?
I think it's a risk, which is why I want you in their faces 24/7, reminding them who they work for, and watching out for telltale signs of misguided idealism.
Misguided idealism?
If they fall in line, they'll be a tremendous asset. If they get in our way, they're going to be a hell of a pain in the ass, in which case we need advance warning so that we can take preventative measures.
When do I leave?
As soon as the plane's done fueling. You'll be kicking up your heels in the Oval Office by sundown.
Listen, Sarah. Do you have a moment?
Of course.
I wanted to personally let you know that I'm leaving for D.C. in a couple of hours.
Isn't that risky?
I've been assured I'll be quite safe.
When are you back?
Hard to say.
Wow.
Yeah, but I'm thinking of putting you in charge of things here. If you think you're up for it.
Wow, of course.
Good. That's good. In that case, I'll need to go over some things with you, one-on-one.
Sure. Okay.
It's hard to guarantee privacy in my office.
We can use my quarters.
Good idea. You must be Barton Schaefer. I've heard great things.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't listen to idle talk. I'm pretty lacking in redeeming qualities.
Right. Aren't we all?
So, let's talk about this cure-all snake oil I'm supposed to ship out of here.
Yes, about that. The situation is a bit complicated.
No offense, but all I need from you is information. I can do my own assessment when I have all the facts.
Okay. Well, here's a fact. We can't get into the facility without my briefcase, which is apparently being held at the Capitol by the True Sons. And the Division already has plans to go and get it.
Well, that's perfect. As soon as they hand it to you, you hand it to me. Then we go fetch the goods and we all end up with gold stars on our report cards. It's not complicated at all.
As that was happening, several major criminal gangs fighting viciously for control of the region north of Pennsylvania Avenue call a truce and form a council. This meeting unites the murderous factions into a loose confederation called the Hyenas, who employ insurgent-style tactics. While this was happening, Maryland's National Guard Colonel Antoine Ridgway was promoted to JTF Field Commander, Southeast Region, with the new rank of General. Ridgway began a merciless crackdown on mob violence in the capital. His overzealous and increasingly lethal measures in support of the forced quarantine leads to reprimands and after he was taken prisoner, but he was rescued by his former unit. Ridgway then formed the paramilitary group the Three Sons, and in time secured the Capitol building, becoming the most dominant group in Washington DC. Bitter survivors of the forced quarantine on Theodore Roosevelt Island in the Potomac River overthrow the camp to form a vengeful faction calling themselves the Outcasts. The faction set up its stronghold in the Potomac Event Center and start pushing eastward from the Potomac. As that was happening, the BTSU, under leadership of Schaefer, was in their phase of preparation of their dismantling and elimination of the division and other factions of Washington, D.C.
Hyenas?
That's what they call themselves. Don't ask me.
Huh.
They're essentially an alliance of gangs led by a council of representatives from the toughest subgroups.
Federation of assholes.
Pretty much.
What about the True Sons?
Former JTF commander went bad. Started his own private army. They've been the dominant group in DC for a while, when it comes to territory and firepower.
And the Outcasts?
Crazies.
That's very incisive, Brenner.
They survived a forced quarantine. Got fucked over pretty bad. They're pissed about it. Now they're on the rampage. Typical terror-style tactics, mostly. Dabbling in biological warfare.
What the fuck is wrong with people?
Like I said, crazies.
Well, they're all the division's problem for the time being, but, maybe we can destabilize the situation a bit?
Hyenas are probably the best bet. Feed them some material support, they'll be a thorn in everybody's side, and they aren't organized enough to present a serious problem in the long term.
Good recommendation, Eli. I'll talk to the boss.
Aboard Air Force One, Alice, carrying a briefcase with intel on the location of the broad spectrum antivirals, would fly to Washington, D.C. As they entered the Capitol's airspace, Air Force One was struck by a surface-to-air missile coordinated by the True Sons, resulting in the aircraft crashing in front of the Capitol building. The site was then scavenged by hyenas who found Alice and took him back to their headquarters in the World Bank Group. With Alice presumed dead, the BTSU had to come up with another plan.
We have to assume there were no survivors.
So what does that mean for us?
A new plan and a new enemy.
Division?
Bingo.
Then we need to do something about their advantages.
That's the new plan.
Where are we supposed to get that kind of intel?
We already have it. I got a list of key targets right here.
We're seriously going after the division?
We are seriously going after them, and we are going after them seriously. We are gonna gag them, blind them, kick them in the nuts, and steal their lunch money.
This is gonna be fun. We finally agree on something.
In a stand-up fight, a couple of division agents ain't nothing to worry about. The problem is getting them in a stand-up fight. They're crafty fuckers.
They've got a vulnerability. Same one anybody has when they're trying to protect something.
There are also traitors among them that we can use to our advantage.
The first step is to cripple their network. That'll expose them, make them weak. Then we start picking them off.
With Alice's supposed death, a confrontation with the division was unavoidable. As Black Tusk was specialized in precision and low exposure operations, they would supply the hyenas with equipment, causing them in turn cause trouble against the other factions and the division. Then, through to their tactics, without exposing themselves, the BTSU would disable the Shade network.
Man, fuck these flies! Ain't there enough dead shit in this town to entertain them?
They're an indication of how bad you stink, Bonnie. Flies are more attracted to you than to dead things.
Shut the hell up, both of you. Some of us are working here. You call staring at the motherfucking White House working? It's the opposite of working.
Nobody ever said Savannah's is supposed to be fun. At least nobody wasn't a fucking idiot.
Bonnie doesn't think it's fun, but he's still a fucking idiot.
All of you, zip it. It's like being on a bus ride with a bunch of grade schoolers.
They started it.
I swear to God, Bonnie.
Movement. South Lawn. Is it a division agent?
Yep. I can just make out the wristwatch.
Galveston, Bonnie, you're up. Find out where he goes.
Are you really gonna stick me with stinking me flybait here?
Less moaning, more mobilizing. Go, go, go!
That's so hilarious.
I'm personally a fan of what y'all do. Really, I am. I admire righteousness. Even if I rarely partake.
You're not getting anything from me.
You see, that's where you're mistaken. because one thing I can tell you about myself is that I'm persuasive. And I need to locate a certain bunker y'all are using to house some of your infrastructure.
But I don't know anything about that.
Then I'm sorry in advance that you're gonna do a bit of suffering for no good reason.
You're wasting your time!
I gotta disagree with you there. What I'm doing is my job, and doing your job is never a waste of time. Especially if you do it with pride and conviction. Sure you don't want to save us both some unpleasantness?
That was invigorating. Like going up against a team of fucking superheroes, you know what I mean?
How about you shut up and get the charges planted?
I'm working on it.
And more working, less jabbering.
Jesus, Brenner, why are you so penned up all the time? You need to unclench your ass cheeks.
He would, but he's worried his batteries will fall out.
fuck yourselves. Why are you always taking his side?
I'm on the side of truth.
Whatever. Let's just blow this fucking place so we can turn these superheroes into ordinary assholes, all right?
The Division's network is the agency's core technology. It links numerous dedicated assets directly controlled by the Division, such as drones, unmanned aerial vehicles or AWACS airplanes, and telecommunication satellites, and piggybacks their output onto existing civil, commercial, and military networking structures to create a seamless global web of connectivity and data. The network connects agents in the field to the Division headquarters and to strategic decision makers through shade nodes. The BTSU disabled both the primary shade node hidden in a decommissioned Cold War era nuclear military bunker below the Washington Underground Gallery and multiple secondary nodes scattered across the city. Their sabotage created a catastrophic failure in the shade network, causing shade tech in a 50-mile radius to go offline and cut off communication with agents across the country. Protocol dictates agents from all over the country are sent to Washington DC and restore their network.
Okay.
Shut it! Someone shut the perimeter!
See to those barricades. And have someone radio the patrol so we have a lookout for stragglers. Some of those bastards got away. I didn't expect another attack so soon. You okay? If this keeps up, we're gonna have to relocate. Come on, help me with this. We're stretched too thin to protect everyone here. Not again.
Get to the waterfront!
That can't be right. For Washington, D.C. How is this possible?
Get down! Everybody get down!
Someone has to stay. We can't just leave these people here. Whatever happened, it needs to be fixed or it's all over. You go! I'll do what I can here. Go!
Black Tusk's origins and timeline are extensive and in-depth. This was the first part of a 3 or 4 part series on the story of Black Tusk. Intel answered important questions, yet many questions are left that we will discover the answers to in the upcoming videos. The creation of this video in particular was very time consuming. Writing the script, so far only written up until the end of Warlords of New York, has already consumed 15 pages. Designing the motion graphics and editing everything together took weeks. And those are just a few parts of the process that is creating a video like this. So, if you enjoy these videos and appreciate the work that goes into it, consider showing me some support in one of the following 4 ways.
liking or disliking, depending on what you thought of the video. Other than views, this shows me how much you like the content I put out. Subscribing reinforces your support and shows me you want more videos. Leaving interactive comments or feedback reminds me how I'm not just doing it for myself and shows how I can improve. And the last way to support me is to join the channel and become a member for $1, $5, or $10. Other than badges and emojis, I haven't created rewards yet, but I'm always open to suggestions. With that in mind, I wanted to say thanks to two people. Firstly, I want to say thank you to Hidden Foxstyle for being the first and at the moment only member of the channel. And the second person I want to thank is Shade Agent Ghosthunter for recording the voiceover of Roger Koopman. Links to his socials can be found in the description. And that thanks extends to the others that have sent in their voiceovers as well. With that said, the more support I gain, the more time and energy I can invest in YouTube, and in turn, this will result in more frequent uploads and higher quality content. Whatever you decide to do, I'll be here because I like what I do. Thanks again for watching. Peace out.